founded the Bach Network in UK in 2004, and its open access peer-reviewed journal, Understanding Bach. And that happened in 2006. Ruth Tatlow currently serves as chair of the Bach Network Council and on the editorial board of the American Bach Society. And she doesn't like to hear introductions about herself, but I could insist you in, just to get an idea of who is here with us. And can't we talk about the Germanics?
Jag kommer att prata på engelska tyvärr, men när vi ställer frågor så kan vi göra det på svenska och jag försöker svara. Men för att förbereda på svenska, det är lite svårt, lite utmaning.
Tack så mycket.
Så, jag ska inte överskrida halv en, varför det är helig kaffepart. Did Bach use proportions when he composed? And if he did, which proportions did he use? And was he the only composer at the time to work in this way? These are some of the questions I will address in this short presentation. There's been a lot of talk over the past 50 years about Bach and number symbolism with mystical interpretations. Unfortunately, there was hardly any evidence, any concrete source evidence for these wondrous ideas that some musicians like to imagine that we found in Bach's music. And so I decided to investigate the factual basis behind numbers in music, aiming to find out if Bach and his contemporaries knew or even could have used number devices in their compositions, and if they did, what they meant. To my great surprise, I discovered that Bach did use numbers when he composed. More specifically, he used the number of bars to create layers of proportions in his compositions. He did this after he had composed the music, when he was revising it as part of the revision process, particularly when he was putting already composed pieces of music together to form groups or collections which he was then going to publish. He made layers of perfect proportions at every level of the work, so they appear between a movement, across a whole collection, within a movement, between movements, across a whole collection, and between collections, so from the micro to the macro. So that in one publication, there may be as many as four layers of perfect one-to-one or one-to-two proportion. The numbers themselves rarely have any symbolic or mystical meaning. Rather, it was the proportions that held the significance. These parallel layers of one-to-one and one-to-two proportions can be seen in all of his publications, including the complete Klavierübung series, the musical offering, the canonic variations, the Chute de Chorales, and the Art of Fugue, as well as in those compositions for which Bach made a perfect calligraphic top copy, which includes the Brandenburg concertos, the six solos for violin, Well-tempered Clavier Book 1, the two-part inventions in three-part symphonii, the six organ sonatas, the Leipzig chorales, the Mass in A, and the Symphony Passion. Many people don't realize that during Bach's lifetime, these were not published, these last few. Now, scholars discovered long ago that Bach added movements and extra bars to compositions when he revised them for publication, even though there was often no obvious musical reason for the change. So that's not new, that was proven. But what I have discovered is why Bach added these movements and these extra bars. He did it to make his compositions perfectly proportioned. Now, you've got to look at some evidence to support this spectacular claim. Firstly, we need to know if proportions were important to composers in Bach's time. So I'm going to give you bits of evidence. Johann Mattheson, who was a music theorist whose writing Bach knew, said that the composer should observe well sections and divisions of the main parts of a composition. And later he recommends more specifically how to do it, saying, the best way of all to ensure that each part of a composition demonstrates a specific proportion, or verhältnis in German, a specific proportion, uniformity, and agreement is to order all the parts and details of an entire melodic composition, just as you would design a house, just as an architect would design a house, making a sketch or plan to show where a room, a sitting room, a chamber, a bedroom should be placed. The German word translated here as proportion is Verhalt or Verhältnis, which in Bach's time meant a specific mathematical proportion or arithmetical proportion, and not relationship, as it's often translated in a general sense. Architectural plans in Bach's time, as today, were detailed, and they included specific measurements. And so if the composer in Bach's time wished to follow Mattheson's advice and to copy architectural practice to ensure that each part of a composition demonstrated a specific mathematical proportion, the composer would need specific measurements for his composition. How would he measure it? So we need to know now which unit the composer would use to create proportions. For example, a composer could decide to create a one-to-one proportion within six movements of a work with 3 to 3 of a specific type, or six works in a collection, 3 each, similar and 3 different. Just as an architect could decide on 6 rooms in a building of similar type, or 6 buildings in a complex. And just as the architect would then decide on the exact dimensions of the room or building, using a local unit of measurement to create his one-to-one proportion in the ground plan, the composer would need some way to measure music. So which measurement would a composer like Bach use? My investigations into Bach's music show that he chose the bar as this unit. And in 1708, Bach's second cousin, Walter, J.D. Walter, confirmed that at this time the bar, or takt, was used to measure sound, time, and pitch. Johann Mattheson again used it to measure pulse in his fourth rule of compositional clarity, writing that the number of bars, the number of takt, should be proportioned. And Walter used it to measure the length of different types of movement. For example, he defines the ritornello as having 8 or 12 or 16 takt bars. The gavotte with the first reprise in 4 bars, and the second in 8, and so on. And in 1754, Bach's pupil Mitzler used the bar when he described how to calculate the duration of a church cantata, saying that 350 bars of any meter, so he wasn't saying the adagio should be different, of any meter, 350 bars would take about 25 minutes in winter. And in summer, 490 bars and 35 minutes when the churches were warmer. So this rule of thumb of minutes against the number of bars, which shows very clear proof and demonstration that it was a practical tool, the bar was a practical tool for them. So this shows that the bar was used to measure the length of a composition. It was a common and a useful unit of measurement in Bach's time, and there's also plenty of evidence to show that Bach himself was aware of how many bars he wrote. The number of bars, of course, helped the composer and the copyist to make an economic and accurate copy from scores or of a score on very expensive paper. They had to check they actually got the right number when they were copying parts. Or if they were making a copy because there weren't so many things published, they had to check that they got the same number. And very often in scores at this time, you do get at the end of a movement the bar number, and you usually know that this is a copyist or somebody who's checking that they've actually done it correctly. When Bach was composing the newly composed Confiteor in Simorum Niceum of the B minor Mass, for example, he wrote the figures 61, 100, and 104. 41 at the bottom of three consecutive pages corresponding to bars 61, 100 and 141. And this was not just copying, because it was newly composed in its composing style, it's his composing hand, it's highly likely that he was actually at this point aiming for a specific length of this movement to fit in to the rest of all the written. So in summary, we can say confidently that proportions were important to Bach and his contemporaries. Theorists of his time recommended using the bar to form proportions across the compositions, as you've heard Mattheson said, and Bach and his contemporaries knew exactly how many bars they composed. So this evidence supports my claim that Bach could have planned a well-ordered composition and that he could have created proportions at several structural levels, but it doesn't prove it. We need to weigh up evidence from Bach's compositions to decide whether the theory matches Bach's practice. Now, you can read more evidence in my book, Bach's Numbers, that little thing that I weighed. I put some of these at the back just as a reminder. It says 20% off, but it's actually cheaper if you were to buy it from Walmart or something where you don't have to pay the postage. So just you can take one and use it as a bookmark if you feel so inclined. And in that book, you can read more evidence with theoretical evidence in part one and the demonstrations in part two. But for now, I'm going to give you a new example, an example that's not in my book, but I wanted to do it on the Reformation BWV 80 that you're going to hear this evening. Ein fester Wort ist mein Gott, and it actually fits in nicely with what Robin said. So, Bach, just a little tiny summary. Bach first composed this cantata for Occhi Sunday on the 24th of March 1750 as a 16-movement cantata based on text by Salomon Frank. He then expanded, revised, and polished it in the late 1730s to become the version that we'll sing tonight, Cantata 80, for the Reformation Festival. And as I said earlier, it was when Bach revised his compositions that Bach introduced these layers of proportion. So therefore, it was very important that I had some evidence of the revision process. It wasn't just one free composition. So, as expected, this polished version does contain several layers of proportional ordering. Firstly, he made the overall structure of the new version symmetrical. And of course, symmetry is the quintessential one-to-one proportion over a central axis. That is, it's a mirror image. That is what symmetry is. One part identical to the other part, one-to-one. Bach created this symmetry by positioning the three new movements with text by Martin Luther around the existing five movements that he had already composed, putting one new movement at the beginning, one at the end, and one in the middle. That is, the vast opening chorale movement, Ein fester Wort ist unser Gott, at the beginning, the chorale, Und wenn die Welt voll Teufel wäre, in the middle, and the final chorale, Das Wort, Sie sollen lassen schauen, at the very end. These three new movements were settings of verses 1, 3, and 4 of Luther's chorale, Ein fester Wort. And secondly, Bach created a one-to-one symmetry with the number of bars across the cantata, making sure that these three new movements that he positioned symmetrically would create a perfect one-to-one proportion with the number of bars in the movements he was reusing from the early version. And this is the typical way he worked. So he already had 245 bars of composition. In fact, he had more because he decided not to use the original first movement. So he reduced it, so he saved 245 bars. 77 bars in the soprano and bass aria mit unser Macht, 25 bars in the bass recit, 36 bars in the soprano aria Komm in mein Herzenhaus, 17 in the tenor recit, and 19 bars in the alto and tenor duet, Wie selig sind doch die, die Gott im Munde tragen, which is altogether 245 bars, believe me. And I can't put a PowerPoint to show you, but that group, the original group, is 245 bars. And he made sure that the three new Luther movements also had our movement, I invested walk is Unsergott, is 114 baht and not 228, as Robin said. I'll mention that in a minute. The way he wrote it, it's the anti-criminal station, it has 140. The central corral, Und wenn die Welt vom Teufel wäre, has 119 bars. And the final corral, Das Wort sie sollen lassen stehen, has 12 bars, or 16 bars if he included the bar repeats in the first stolle. In summary, he created a double symmetrical structure with 245 to 245 bars, which is 1-to-1, across the entire cantata, symmetrically arranged around the three newly composed youth movements at the beginning, middle, and end. One further small detail, our modern copy has 8 movements, but in the surviving original score, which is not in Bach's handwriting, but in the handwriting of his son-in-law, Altmigol, there is no double bar line after aria 2, which effectively runs into the bass recit, and in this way, I'm going to tweak, but in this way, you can imagine it as a 7-movement cantata with 3 new movements, literally movements 1, 4, and 7, but it won't look like that in your score, which makes it perfectly symmetrical. So, we have some evidence of Bach's proportion, but we need to know how did he do it, because it needs to support figures that, after all, may just be coincidence, so it's better to have some real evidence. How would you do it? Well, there were several points of wiggle room in Bach's choices, as always. To begin with, Bach had to decide which of the old movements he would reuse, and as I said, he kept 5 and 6. I'm calling it 6. I'm calling it 5 of 8, even though I've said it might be 7. So he kept 5 of the original 6. And then there was the choice of whether or not he could use the repeated bars in his counting, and Bach decided to exclude this. This meant that he had the starting point of 5 movements in 245 bars. And then he had to decide how to notate the 3 newly composed movements. This was always a point. How do you notate? And this enormously long setting of the first verse, Ein Festival, he chose the Stile Antico notation for this, which is cut common time with 4 minims. What's a minim? Halfnot? Führer Halfnot? Minim? Führer Halfnot per bar, rather than notating it as a tour. So it, instead of being 4-4, it is, it's 4-2. This movement, therefore, is just 114 bars long. Bach uses this very often, this system, very often in the late 1730s and onwards, this Stile Antico notation, and it was very intentional. Whereas the old Bach-Gesellschaft edition, and maybe a modern edition, I don't know, they tend to rationalize the performance reasons and the extra bar lines, it makes it easier to read. But this choice, these choices, enable these 3 newly composed movements to have exactly 244 bars and to create the altogether all-important 1-to-1 proportion with these Luther-texted movements. This is unfortunately a very simple demonstration. You really do need the larger things where we have evidence for more revisions. But anyway, I just thought it might be fun to show you what he did here. So, having looked at the evidence of how Bach created this 1-to-1 proportion, I would like now to ask why he did it. Because this is the most interesting thing. Firstly, I'm going to answer in general, and then specifically for Cantata 18. 2 citations will give a taster of the theological and moral significance that the proportion, 1-to-1 proportion, or the unity held for Bach and his Lutheran contemporaries. There was a motto that was upheld as the principle for all artists. It was originally from Aristotle, but it got transferred, and it was quoted by many music theorists at this time, including Bach's second cousin, Walter. The closer a proportion is to the unity or equality, that is 1-to-1, the more perfect and intelligible it is. The further a proportion is from this unity, the more imperfect and confusing it is. The composer and theorist J.J. Fuchs adapted this principle, preferring the proportion 1-to-2, which is the same proportion as an octave in a monochord. One to one is the same as the unity. You have a string, and you put a bridge in the middle, and you pluck either side of the bridge, that sounds a unity. If you have a string and you divide it into three parts, and you put the bridge up to one part and the two parts here, that is one to two, and you pluck it. This one here is an octave higher than this. And they use this for demonstrations of tuning, but also as a visual demonstration of how God created the world, because they believed that the universe and all the planets were ordered according to this harmony of the, it just goes up till 5 to 6, or the mind word. That's too much information for now, but believe me that there was more to it than tuning and pitches. So J.J. Fuchs in 1725 wrote, "The octave, which is 1 to 2, is contained in many things, and its inherent proportions make it the most perfect interval of all. And this is the important thing. It can easily be seen that this octave ordering was wonderfully adhered to by God in all his works and in all his creatures." Now, Lutheran artists copied the perfect ideal ordering that they believed God had used when he created the world and all creatures. Wherever they looked, they saw this demonstration of God's order, and they copied it in the symmetrical facades of their Baroque buildings, and Bach created it in the symmetry of his polished and revised collections and compositions. Now, this gives us a general reason why Bach would have created symmetrical order in this cantata for the Reformation Festival, but it is possible to read even more into his choices. He based the new structure, as I said, on 245 and 245 bars, that is on 490 bars. This is clearly a number related to 7 squared, if your arithmetic is all right. 7 times 7 is 49. Or 7 times 70 is literally 490. So why did Bach choose this particular figure as the basis for a Reformation cantata? I'm going to make a suggestion. In one of the most famous Reformation statements, Martin Luther described the 7 marks of the Church in his 1539 essay on the councils and the Church. In it, he defines the Church not as a building or as an institution, but as the gathered people of God centered on the word of Christ, characterized by these 7 marks: God's word, baptism, sacrament of the altar, power of forgiveness of sins, consecrated calling of ministers, prayer, possession of the cross. And as we know, Bach had at least 2 copies of this essay, and it would have been well known. It was in 1539. So my question is, did Bach choose to build his Reformation cantata as a signifier, even as an emblem of Luther's analysis of the Reformed Church for this Reformation festival, 7 times 70 in 490 bars? In his copies of Luther's work, Bach will have seen that Luther wrote this essay in 1539. Might this even suggest that Bach polished this cantata for the 1739 Reformation Festival, just 200 years later than Luther's 7 marks of the cross, 7 marks of the Church? And we can add that to Roblin's evidence. They don't know, the Bach scholars have not said this is the 1739, but I'm wondering if this specific number may suggest it was. And there may even be one more motivation that made the choice of 490 bars seem just right to Bach. The signature form that he used most frequently is Yo Seb Bach, which in the most common number alphabet used at the time happens to be 70. So when you translate it, J is 9, O is, can't remember how many, 14 I think, H is 8, and you add this up, B-A-C-H is 14, you get 70. So might there have been an element of artistic self-reference in his choice also, a duality, a parallel of 490 bars for this Reformation cantata celebrating the 7 marks of the Church, written by Joseph Bach, symmetrically arranged with 3 texted movements. by Martin Luther, at this time emblematic. Dual meanings, parallel meanings were very, very important and part of the whole way we saw the world. One can continue to generate interesting links and associations, but the further one moves from proven sources, the more dangerous and fantastic the interpretations can come. And so I'm going to stop at that point and conclude with some concrete evidence about Bach and proportion. In Bach's time, proportions were considered to be spiritually important and aesthetically pleasing. Perfect proportions were understood to be fundamental to the construction of the universe, fundamental to the construction of the human body. Bach had no arcane or mysterious intentions. On the contrary, I suspect that he worked hard to create symmetrical and proportional order, to create beauty and perfection, and that he aspired with practical tools to emulate the ultimate beauty and perfection of God. This evening you will hear, or I think sing, Cantata 80 with its perfectly proportioned 490 bars, symmetrically framed with these three texted Martin Luther movements. Will you hear or feel the perfect symmetrical order? The answer is that we don't know enough about human perception of time and space to be absolutely certain. But I can say with confidence that generations of listeners have spoken about their experience of the architectural grandeur and the structural perfection of Bach's works, even though there was no real demonstrative proof that I'm now presenting. I suspect, therefore, that you might sense a symmetry or a rightness in this cantata. And now you know that underlying this intuition are the literal proportions that Bach worked hard to create. Thank you.
Hur ni kommer uppleva det här nu ikväll, när ni kommer ihåg att det är ju fascinerande. Det kommer att vara en klient efteråt här. Sen är jag väldigt spänd.
Och med det här ändrade dagsprogrammet så har vi en mer fin eftermiddag. Så vår tanke var att vi skapar framförallt utrymme med fyra tiderna för frågor. Och Mikael, domkyrkoorganist och föregångare här, har redan givit mig fyra intressanta frågor. Skriv nära gärna ner och er, utifrån förmiddagen här så ska vi kunna få en fin diskussion för er. Tack så hemskt mycket. Nu får vi se om proportionen mellan tapp och vatten är bra. Ja, tack.